In this journey, it's Blanchett Zoo. Now this is something really new to me. I didn't even know what the heck it was until it was requested of me for this model. It's not like I didn't know who John Blanche was, I mean I did grow up with 3rd edition, but I always just thought he was a messy painter. Little did I know that that's actually evolved into a style of grim, dark, and gritty. The model I've been tasked with turning into Despair Incarnate is this Centauri soldier. Every bone in my body tells me to paint him with nice blends and light effects, but that's not the goal this time around, so it's time to make him look like he's been through the Saw movies. Well, if the whole point is to make him gritty, then why not start with some grit? In my research on the style, I've seen lots of really gritty models. That was on purpose, mind you, but I think a lot of it came from using textured paints on the model itself instead of just the bases they were intended for. I'm not that brave to go all over, so just on his legs I'm applying some thinned out white glue mixed with a small bit of sand, just to get some of that grit sporadically around. With all the washes and pigment I'll be applying later, it should give me some nice places to pool around. As I apply it, I try and keep most of the sand around his ankles, and just feather it up his legs a bit so there's only a few grains closer to his hips. Some of the other articles I looked up said to start on a zenithal prime, to which I say sure, but I'm doing it my way. No white and black here. Basically, I want him to have a base of metallics. Like the armor was made of metal before time and low lighting situations got to him, which means instead of black, I'm starting with a dark brown. Mine made from Chimera colors orange and black, but of course if you're following along, any dark brown will do. Once the base coat is down and dried, I'll do some zenithal with metallics. Metallics are a pain in the butt with airbrushes, especially when it comes to narrow nozzles like the 0.15mm I use, so I use lots of thinner. And since I just want the hint of metallics, I'm not going on all that heavy, just picking out points in the prominent areas and letting lots of that brown still show through. For this one, if you've got a spray can metallic, use that, but if you have an airbrush, just make sure the metallic you use with it are airbrush safe. Scale 75's are airbrush grade, which is what I use, but I know both GW and Vallejo have separate metallics designed for airbrush in their paint lines, so just be careful. Since I'm already here, I might as well do a bit of metallic highlighting too. Just a lighter shade of metal, on his face and every extraneous area with some airbrush as well. Brush I'm sure would be fine too, since most of the stuff to make it gritty is going to be happening on top of it. Before I start adding top coats and colors, I really want to push the contrast. Take my brightest areas and make them bright, and my darks and make them really dark. Because so much will be going over top, I want to make sure what's underneath shows through really well still. So to highlight, I'm taking my most silver and getting all the sharp edges, using a combination of the tip of the brush along valleys and rounded areas, and the edge of the brush wherever there's room to get a nice straight edge. Now that we got all the ups, time to get all the downs. Along a lot of this guy, there's gaps. Gaps that inks and washes would settle in, but unevenly. I want to control this chaos a bit, so before I do any of that, I'm going to be adding some black lining. This will separate parts more evenly than just a wash, and should help those really dark shadows add volume through the grim dark I'm going to be making him after. Last few things to do for prep now are to add some color where things need color. The skulls hanging off him back here need a full colorization, so I start with a saturated brown, then highlight in layers up to a bone white. It doesn't have to be too neat, as like everything else, it's gonna get some Blanchitzu. And I want some of these cables to have a pop of color as well, so I'm going with a traditional Blanche color of using a yellow ochre just to give them a base. Then I wet blend a bit of brown that I use for the skulls towards the start and end points, just so it kept to the dark and dirty theme. And since all the colors are already there, why not do a scabbard in leather too? Mixing the brown with some black, I add a base coat to it. Then while it's still wet, just mix up some of the yellow and bone together. Keeping all the colors the same, the palette will remain similar, but I do want to change them up a bit from the skulls. Just kind of being messy with it and dotting it around the edges, and adding a bit of scratching. Then just a mix of the bone and yellow to lighten up those highlight points a bit more to retain the contrast, since I'll be needing it. and then add a bit of the yellow back in with a simple glazing. And because I felt it was too much of a big scratch, added some brown black to the middle of it to bring it back to normal. Now I'm getting to the dark part of Grim and Dark. So right now he looks pretty good. He's just very shiny, a little too pristine. So to correct that, I'm going to be doing a wash with the matte version of Nuln Oil, but not just your standard wash. For one, I cut it with a lot of water. This isn't about thinning it, but reducing its potency. As I start to do the wash, it seems like it's not going to make much difference. But what I do once it's applied is using my brush tip, actually stipple the wash around to have it pool on the flat parts. What I'm doing is trying to make the wash model some over the metallics. As it dries, it should leave some parts with a heavier wash than others, and not just in the crevices. That will have an effect of overall just toning down the model, but in a textured old metal kind of way. And just to make sure the effect really shows up, add some more stippling around randomly once the first layer dried, with the same mix as before. Now if I was to have a guess at what you might be thinking, it would be, wow, that already looks quite grim. But we're just getting started. This is just the blank canvas for the mayhem I'm about to unleash on this guy. I went and grabbed everything I could think of we can do to this guy. I got my weathering pigments, some earthy greens, some alternate browns, and every pukey yellow I could find, as well as some of the GW washes, and my wildwood contrast. I want to save the weathering pigments for the end, since they won't be fixed to the model, so I'm going to start with an experiment. I want to go in and corrode some of the joints a bit, but like the Nuln Oil, I want to keep the other washes thin as well. So what I'm thinking is, I do a wash with a thinned Argrax shade, but while it's still wet, using the tip of my brush, apply stippling of the wildwood contrast to it. By doing it this way, I should end up with those heavy browns in the deep recesses, but blend it out by the wash, which will change the color of the surrounding parts to match. I feel like as I do this, this combo works really well. The mix for the wash ran out pretty quickly, so I started just taking it right from the pot and watering it down with just my brush by adding more water to it than needed. The contrast spread out through the wet wash, creating a nice blend, so that when the whole thing dried, you had these deep dark brown parts, while the wash just tinted the surrounding area. I think it worked best on the back of the leg, where it was quite bright to begin with. Now I think it's time to introduce some of that overall color to the model. So I'm going to use the airbrush for this, along with a dark earthy green, and kind of a brownish yellow. Specifically, raw umber from the Scale Artist line, and peanut butter from their Fantasy and Games line. With the green first, I'm loading it into my airbrush in a very thinned out way, not too much paint for the amount of thinner I've got in there, since this is going to be more for overall color change in large areas. Spraying it not too far away, but not right up close either, I add some layers of green, just in general spots around the model. Anywhere I feel he hasn't been touched with other stuff, like his shoulders and the back of his head. Not even caring if I get it on his scabbard. I want this mostly see-through, as it's going to kind of act like the wash I did in the previous step as a blending base. But you can see some of that dark hue shift from the black and metal to a dark green with each new added layer. For the highlight in the color change, that's where the bright puke yellow comes in. So keeping it thinned like I did before, just a bit more pigment this time as I'll be getting pretty close with the tip of my airbrush to the model, and going very slow with the air to avoid spidering. Just building up layers gradually to add more and more transparent yellow to these joints and shoulders. No real rhyme or reason why I'm getting the parts I am, and from whatever angle. Since it's the zenithal and the highlighting that's kind of determining our light direction, I can be as sporadic with this as I want, just slowly building up layers until I'm happy with what I see. So at this stage it looks pretty good, looking very dark, and the bit of color adding to the grimness. But it's just in my nature to be subtle about things. So far I've done subtle shadows, subtle highlights. I guess I'm afraid of ruining hard work with anything definitive in case it doesn't work as I imagined, but I feel like that's one of the key lessons of Blanchitsu, is to throw away that subtlety and don't worry about messing up, but instead worry about messing it up. So no more Mr. Subtle. Going all in now, washes and pigment powder, using sepia and a dark brown powder mix. This is going to be for his legs, which at first I apply a bit of water to keep it damp,
While I'm not afraid of a mess right now, I am afraid of seeing brushstrokes, so that should keep them out of the picture at least. Then after a deep breath, just go for it, slathering that mix all over his legs over top of what else was there. The wash will kind of act like my binder for the pigment, which should dry powdery and opaque. And since I'm already in for a penny, why not just do the same with the black powder in deep recesses, and anything that looks like it grinds on something else. These cables haven't seen much action, so no escaping the crazy paint man now. Once it all dried up, we got this dirty mess, and since that mess is around the grit we put down earlier, why not really make that stand out with a thin down wash of the contrast, just to give them rings around those gritty areas. So that's what I did. At this point, he's about as grim, dark, and gritty as I'm willing to go. Anything more and I might start losing all of that work I did at the start, though I guess that probably wouldn't bother someone who is used to this style. If you're already willing to put basing material on the model itself, you have no fear and I commend you. I'll work up a base and get to the final product. So do I like how he looks? Absolutely. I think having all that pre-highlighting and shading really helped make sure certain parts stand out through the overall grittiness of the final piece, through all of those layers of grime that were added after. He's dark, but not lacking in any contrast or color, and his overall tone just screams that he's been through it. Is it Blanchitsu? I'll let you all be the judge of that for me.
So let me know how you think I did. Did I miss the mark or just scrape by? Or do you think I really did capture the spirit of the style? Let me know in the comments, and subscribe if you want to see more adventures. Because while I may not be a journeyman painter, I am a